Hello friends, good morning and welcome to the EduSat Network. Our topic of discussion today is on life and literature, soundingly very interesting, and we would get to know more about it as we progress with the lecture. And for this very lecture and discussion, we have with us in our studio Dr. Anand Prakash, retired professor of English Literature, University of Delhi. Dr. Prakash has a teaching experience of more than 4 decades. With this brief introduction, I would like to welcome sir and also request him to begin our today's lecture. Thank you so much, sir, for coming.
Thanks, Urvashi, and welcome viewers for this discussion on life and literature. It appears to be a bit simple, but if you start looking at it closely, if you start thinking about what could be discussed as a kind of relationship between life and literature, then a large number of windows open up, you know, to give you questions, to give you issues to consider. For instance, what does life mean in the context of literature and vice versa? Life, well, is a human life, social life, political life, life in education, life in the economic field. You know, you have in life, for instance, employers and employees. Employees, you know, always are keen to start the work at a particular time and finish at a particular time, whereas employers want to stretch that time, and a kind of tension always exists between the employer and the employed. So that's the economic life. Then you have ideological life, religious life, cultural life, and life in the villages, life in the cities. Life of the student, life of the girl student or the boy student, life in the hostel, and a large number of other areas of life. So this is what life is, and all of us all the time confront this life vis-a-vis us. You always ask the question, I always ask the question, what am I to do with the life that I am confronted by? And these are the issues, you know, that we always face day in and day out. And what is literature then? If this is what life is, then literature, well, is a composition in words of a phenomena that happens in the mind of the author. The mind starts, you know, taking pictures of the life that the individual writer faces, and then, you know, those pictures are reconstructed by the writer on the page with a pen in hand. These days, the typewriter and the computer. And then, you know, some script is written. And that script is supposed to tell us, the readers who read it, that, well, this is what happens in life. So there are certain writers who are given more to aesthetics, more to the pleasure aspect than to the purpose aspect. So therefore, they would like to create a sound effect. They would like to describe art forms in life. They would like to, so to say, paint through words a situation, and they will take pleasure out of it. So literature has to choose as to what it has to show. The writer is more or less fully free to show what he or she wants to show, what he or she wants to share with the reader. So this is what literature is. We have literature in the form of books, in the form of oral kind of practice. Some people come and talk to us. Literature, they read out to us, they even tell us, speak the words. You have certain tellers of tales. In fact, the very word tale means that it is told by somebody. So that also is literature. There is folk literature. And all these literatures are supposed to basically make the reader and the viewer relaxed. So that, you know, one, through imagination, one gets away from the humdrum and the rather dull routine of life. So this is what literature is. And for this reason, you know, some people start taking literature lightly. There are many homes, innumerable homes in the country, particularly in North India, to which I belong, which have not any concept of literature. The homes don't have any books, you know, which tell stories. In the name of stories, there is only a kind of katha that can be organized, you know, socially in the mohalla, etc. And the Panditji comes, and he comes with some papers, loose papers, and he just opens them and starts reading. And between that, he also gives a running commentary on what has been told earlier. So this is the only thing that is in the name of literature. in the small village and in the small town. But then if this is what literature, if literature is, you know, just to relax, just to entertain us, then serious people in life, like politicians, like economists, like administrators, they would not take literature very seriously. So is that true, that literature should not be taken seriously? In fact, when I started teaching way back in the 1960s, then the economics teacher in my college would not think of you know, talking seriously with a person who was teaching literature. So he would only, you know, give out facts about what India is facing, all those things at that time. But then when my turn came, then he would simply say, well, there must be a story here, there must be a drama here, and there's nothing very useful. But is that true? This is the question I ask, whether there is a kind of significant, useful relationship between life and literature. So this is the aspect, you know, that I thought I should consider after having a series of lectures on specific aspects of literature. I thought one should try to find out as to the relevance of life, literature to life. And of course, when you look at the world as a writer, then relevance of society, relevance of life to literature. So this question is to be considered.
And sir, sorry to interrupt you, but just a certain idea that springs up in my mind is that very often when I think of life and literature and their connection, it brings to my mind that literature most often is a reflection of our life. There are times when we ignore issues or certain things which we see in our lives and we try to ignore them, but it is literature which throws these things back at us, perhaps most visibly in the form of a drama.
I'm glad to be sitting next to a defender of literature. And that is what is true. I myself would do the same thing. That literature is not, you know, just instrumental in something. Literature per se is something that is useful for life. Without literature, where would we be? And it's not merely a question of relaxation. It's also a question of facing up to reality and, you know, living a life of imagination. Now, it's a different construction. Can we have a life of imagination or do we have a life of reality? Well, I don't separate the two. Imagination also is life. Imagination also is reality. But Urvashi rightly say that literature is useful and that you can't, you know, shy away from the fact that literature means a lot to us. And you use the right word, literature is a reflection of life. And when you see a reflection, when you see a picture of life, then you start considering certain aspects of life which will make you grasp the reality of life better than before when you had not seen the picture. So, well, that is theoretically very sound, and in fact this was the purpose that I raised the question, that one should try to consider the relationship in such a manner that we come to finally know the importance of literature in life. So this point has been, well, I think it's quite clear, viewers. And then we, you know, shift to the area of life that literature captures through words. Now, before I do that, I address the question again that Urvashi raised. And, you know, it's a picture of life, of course, it's a reflection of life. And, well, when we use words in literature, when we use language in literature, it's the same language. It is the same words that we use in life. So when those words are transferred from the plane of life to the plane of literature, then life starts entering the field of literature. Where the kind of thing that I am saying, the kind of thing that Urvashi is telling me, suppose you put it on paper, then, you know, it will raise the same kind of issue. Because the word from literary discussion or literature will be transferred to the situation. And if that's in that situation in life, we start thinking of those words, then people, you know, start responding to us. So literature and life are that way interconnected, more or less directly, more or less organically, as if, you know, the literature and life could not be separated. So language is that important thing. Anyway, from this we go on to the next part, whether literature changes along with life, because that is what is important. If literature changes along with life, if life changes and then literature also changes, if literature changes and life also learns its lessons from literature and changes accordingly. If that is the case, if that we can establish, then I think we would have done our job to you know, share with the viewers that, well, the two are interconnected. Now, I give you examples of literature, let's say, in the 15th century. We have discussed it in other lectures, but today directly. Now, there are a large number of illiterate poets in the 14th century, 15th century, 16th century, 17th century, 18th century, 19th century. They are illiterate poets. They never went to school. They never did any formal training in writing. And these people had imbibed the taste for literature through the oral practice that happened at that point of time. People sang songs. Those songs had words. Those songs had meter, of course, but they also had words. And these illiterate poets, they would imbibe the meter. They would start, you know, composing in directly without writing, start composing and singing. And in these 15th and 16th centuries and later, we have these saint poets in India. And these saint poets were singing songs then. They could not write because there was no school and college to go to. So therefore, they would merely sing. So imagine, human beings composed literature in the conditions that were given at that time. So because songs were available and people, they must have heard songs from others and they composed their own songs. And what do these songs tell? Kabir, as I told you, Kabir sings the song telling us that God is one and God has made us as human beings. And we ourselves divide society or certain groups of people into separate categories which have some kind of religion at their center, which is wrong. So he becomes a critic of religious sects and different religions, and he starts saying that God created us as human beings. So this must have been the issue at that point of time. People must also be fighting with one another, or would be made to fight against one another, would made to, you know, mistrust against others. And then, you know, some saint poet would stand up and say, why are you deceiving one another? Why are you playing in the hands of some other forces, some other people? Why don't you get together? And Kabir also would have noticed that, you know, in the field of work, there's no distinction between one person and another. In fact, Kabir would also say, because he would look at women sympathetically, so he'd also say, what is the difference between a man and a woman? And he would say it in his songs. So the point that Kabir is raising at that time is religious tolerance, is some kind of peace and harmony. He's in fact talking of love. He's talking of getting together, sitting together, discussing things, taking a stance. And that he's doing in the 15th and 16th centuries when he's writing. So life was of that kind. There was no education. People were mostly living in villages or small towns. Kabir, of course, lived in Banaras at that time, but he moved around quite a bit. He went to a large number of fairs, and the language in Kabir tells us, you know, that he must have been to Punjab, must have been to even Kashmir, some people would say, or to Bihar or to the south, because his language comes from all these places in the form of words. So he was a great wanderer. So Kabir wandered around. And he had a kind of message to give. And Kabir would like his songs to be understood by people. So see, literature became a means at that point of time of connecting people with one another in a kind of a thread. So you don't have a country then. You don't have the kind of country that India became in the 20th century. But you have a community. And that community has bonds. And those bonds are cultural bonds. And literature has performed this very important role of getting the society together, give them a sense of bonding, and that bonding is social bonding, human bonding, cultural bonding. Don't you think, viewers, that this is the role that literature can play? If literature has played this role in the songs of Meera, in the songs of Kabir, in the songs of Lal Ded, the Kashmiri great woman saint poet, and a large number of poets elsewhere also, Surdas and, you know, Tulsidas and all these people. And imagine Tulsidas was a Pandit and a great scholar, and he could easily compose verses in Sanskrit. But then he decided, because he wanted his message to go across in a language that people understood. Therefore, he started writing in Avadhi. He started writing in what we call the Purabi language that's spoken around, you know, Lucknow, Banaras, and the rest of Uttar Pradesh. So he wrote an epic. Now the second aspect with regard to this bhakti poetry is that there are people who also wrote epics. Kabir didn't write epics. Other saint poets didn't write epics, but some people did. Like Tulsidas himself wrote this famous epic called Ramcharitmanas, and he's in this particular poem talking about a dynasty, talking about a king, then being replaced by another king, then replaced by a third king, etc., from Dashrath to Ram to Bharat and back to Ram. So this entire period is covered through the epic, and there are a large number of tales woven into this fabric of the epic, and then it becomes a kind of, as Urvashi said, reflection of life in India at that point of time. So you can ask this question from me, you can ask this question from yourselves, whether you know the epic writing is also useful for this, or people directly understand only the message of the song. This depends actually on the choice of the author, whether one chooses an epic form to express oneself in, or chooses a song. A song is more direct, a song is more functional, in the sense, you know, that you can sing a song and go elsewhere. But if you have started an epic, then you are stuck to the place for some time. And at the same time, epic, both are also performances. Now, some great singers can sit at one place and sing a song, not merely in 5 minutes or 3 minutes, but they can sing a song in, well, 20 minutes, 25 minutes in the Shastri kind of music. So there can be a baithak there also, and that is dramatic. And epic is meant for, presenting on the stage. So you have Ramcharitmanas performed on the stage in the form of Ramlila. So imagine that one form of literature now gets transferred to another art form, which is drama and theatre at that point of time. So these are the interesting things, and people get together there, and it's a kind of a mela, it's a kind of an assembly. So people come much before the actual action begins, they leave much after the action has ended, and it becomes a social affair where people start discussing their own problems also. So this is the kind of role, you know, that literature plays. And if you read this literature of the, you know, starting from 14th century up to the 18th, 19th century, then you realize that this is what India was. This is how Indians, you know, sang. These are the words they used. This is the kind of language, you know, that they expressed themselves through. And these were the issues that the people took. So are we discussing then literature and or life? And my answer is, we are discussing both. Because this literature presents those issues, and these issues actually have been picked up from life. So life and literature become totally intertwined with one another when we pick up literature from a particular period. Does the changing of life also change the literature, the expression in literature, is the second question. And for that, you know, I take you straight away from the this medieval period to the 19th century, when literature starts using another form, and that form is the prose form. For instance, in the middle of the 19th century, some people in India start writing novels. In the medieval period, there are no novels. There might be some narratives in the form of drama and epic, etc. But the way we understand the term novel, that novel is not there, because that novel requires some kind of a longish description, some understanding of characters, some opinion to be expressed through the presentation of characters, an introduction, talking about certain areas that one wants to capture. Novel is a different form altogether, and this form is seen only in the 19th century. Now one should try to find out how come, you know, that in the 19th century people are writing novels. There is a famous novel that you must have heard of, Umrao Janada. This is the 19th century novel. There are novels written in Bangla by people like Bankim Chandra in the 19th century. They are novels. Tagore himself starts writing in the latter half of the 19th century. They are written in prose, and they are novels. The reason is that in the 19th century, certain pockets in India, they start spreading education. They start stressing the importance of education in those areas. And people regularly go to schools and colleges. They come back. They talk in a formal language, a language that they do not normally speak at home, in one word or two words. They learn to speak long sentences with the teacher in the class. They learn to write long sentences. They can now connect, you know, one sentence with another. And there is a paragraph. Now in that paragraph, there is a whole organic argument developed. Now this is what prose is. In poetry, you can get away without it. You may not, you know, use this particular form. But really, when you're writing prose, then you must, you know, start a point somewhere, and then you have to take it forward. And if you take it forward, then you're extending the scope of prose and are saying things which will capture a different kind of development in life. So suppose there is a problem regarding a young man going from village to the city, take education there, and then get a job. Now this is a process. Now there is a kind of a, you know, very, very clear cut link between the person wanting to get education, going for the education to the city, and there learning the knowledge and the skills finally to become eligible for a job. Now this particular line of development, this can be captured in a novel very clearly. This can also be captured in other forms, but a novel is particularly suited for this kind of an intellectual professional journey. And you will find that this becomes a plot of many novels in the 19th century and later, where you know somebody leaves the home, then goes to the town, gets education and gets settled there after getting a job. And just see, the novel will then start describing what the young man left when he came away from village. He left his home, he left his parents, he left his sisters, etc., he left his friends, he came to the city. When he left those people there, who would look after them? They might in the meantime grow old and then might require help. When he has come to the city, he must have struck relationship with new people. So he would also love them. Maybe he gets married in the town. If he gets married, then he will have children, then he'll totally forget about the village that he left. Now this is the kind of, you know, problem that occurs in life always. And the novels talk about this. In the 19th century England, this started happening, but initially, let me just take examples from India. In the 19th century, this novel becomes a major literary form. The second thing that I say is that 19th century is not a time when people would sing. Singing means enjoy. They would not enjoy singing. Therefore, even that particular form in Hindi-Urdu writing, which is called ghazal, that particular form also is problematized. Ghazal basically was supposed to talk about beauty, talk about love, talk about subtlety, talk about sweetness. So when, you know, people would get together, then somebody will recite a ghazal or sing a ghazal. And when the ghazal was sang, people would say, wow, what a great thing one has said. So a kind of beauty was captured through the ghazal. And ghazal, in fact, was supposed to be nothing but a beautiful creation. But then in the 19th century, there are poets who write ghazals, but not this kind of ghazal at all. They start raising questions in the ghazal, and particularly the ghazals of Ghalib always raise a question. Dile nada tujhe hua kya hai? Aakhir is dard ki dawa kya hai? Why is he calling his dil nadan? Nadan is helpless, nadan is ignorant. So he is asking his own mind, his own heart as to what has happened to you. And then he says, aakhir is dard ki dawa kya hai? Which means there is a pain inside and he wants some remedy for this. Why is he thinking of pain? Why is he talking to his, this is not the subject of ghazal at all. A ghazal is supposed to be a creation of beauty, and this person is raising questions. So if you go into the spirit and the nature of ghazal in general and the ghazal that somebody wrote in the 19th century, then, and you see the difference, then you start wondering as to what has happened to the ghazal. And ghazal is literature. So perhaps then from literature you will move back to life. You will say there must have been something in the 19th century which compelled a writer to express himself like this. So see the connection of life and literature. Ghalib talks about this particular pain that he is feeling. He is not telling us what the pain is, but then he is compelling us to go to the 19th century life, 19th century reality that Ghalib faced. And you find out from well-telltale accounts of it, from other forms of literature, that North India in particular and the rest of India in general was facing a large number of upheavals and tumults in the 19th century, and writers felt very uncertain regarding their moorings, and therefore they expressed themselves in the form of apprehension, in the form of danger. So this is what happened in the case of India in the 20th century. Once again there is a kind of vigor that Ghalib's helplessness is gone, and what you see in the 19th century, 20th century, is a voice of protest. Ghalib would not protest, Ghalib would deny. Ghalib would sometimes show his anger and his annoyance, but he will not express his protest. But when you come to the 20th century, then you realize that in Urdu and Hindi and in other languages, you have an emotion of anger and an urge to protest. And well, the word India occurs again and again in the 20th century. So India has become, India has emerged as a nation, as a well-knit country, as a country which has some kind of a cohesion at the center of it. And literature is talking about patriotism, is talking about anti-imperialism, is talking about the economic policies of the British regime, is talking about freedom, is talking about Swaraj, is talking about some kind of reform in India, modernity. All these words which were never heard earlier, these words become commonplace in the 20th century writing in India. And once again the question is asked, where are these words coming from? The answer, from life. And is life enjoying this kind of reference in literature? You answer the question whether people in general, they liked this kind of literature or not, or whether they learned from literature or not. And then we realize that the songs of Kabir would instill a sense of anger and questioning in the minds of the rural Bengal and the urban Bengal. And Bengal would go still further in expressing its anger politically in the 20th century. So what I'm saying is that it's not that life changes literature, it is also that literature changes life. Another example I can give from Subramanya Bharati, in the Tamil poet who also wrote in English or translated his Tamil poems into English himself. So this poet starts talking about a violent protest against the Britishers, and this protest should be built upon the collectivity of the workers and the peasants. He starts saying this. It's a very politically loaded statement. If somebody says that the worker should rise in revolt and the peasant should rise in revolt against the peasants, then what he's saying is that don't make any difference between the peasant in South India and North India. Then he's saying peasants. Then he's saying workers. And maybe in a factory there are workers who come from different parts of India. So India already has become one in the factory. So if Subramanya Bharati refers to the peasants or workers or refers to women of India, then of course already a kind of nationalism has set in. Why nationalism? Because he is also writing in English. An Indian poet writing in the early 20th century in English, if he talks about workers, then indirectly he is also connecting with the workers in England. After all, workers are workers, and their work is always linked with the work elsewhere. So the person from nationalist also becomes an internationalist poet. So just see that literature becomes so large in the 20th century because it is being used by the sense of resistance and the sense of revolt, that the regime starts apprehending some kind of a danger from this kind of a literature. After all, they had no right to rule India from a distance. They should have come here, they should have joined the mainstream, they should have become Indians, and then they should have fought along with other Indians the evils and ills of society that existed at that time. But no, they always remained foreigners. They always took away whatever resources they had found here back to their own country, and that was imperialism. And this imperialism people did not like. So what I'm saying is that when this danger came from literature to the political establishment, from those people who wanted to curb freedoms here and to exploit economic and social resources from this place, then the sense of threat that they got compelled them to be harsh with writers. And I'm particularly bringing this point, that literature became so very effective that writers had to be arrested and sent to jail. Now on one side it's very inhuman and cruel, on the other side it's very heroic for the writer who is writing. Now he knows that this is the significance of his writing. If he gets published or if he gets known in the country and people start searching for his books, etc., it's a threat. So it in a sense the society and life have given empowerment to the writer that he can become a threat. And if he's a threat, that's why Subramanya Bharati had to run away from his own place, and he ran away to a place which was under the control of the French in what is that, Pondicherry?
Yes.
He went there and he lived there invisibly, incognito. Nobody knew that he was there. And then some agreement was being reached, and there were problems. Things were getting hot for him, even in Pondicherry. So the point I'm making is that literature is not merely about entertainment, about sweetness. Of course, it's about that also, but then it has to be seen as a very important social factor, you know, which affects life, which, you know, gives us the urge to take up things seriously, analyze them, and like this. Now, here, you know, you can straight away from the Indian situation go to the European situation and see how literature got changed there also. And I'll, because we have very limited time, so before I start with that, and I will have just 5-10 minutes to finish that. So is there anything that you would like to
Yes,
say
sir. I had been waiting for an opportunity. When we started talking about the literature in 20th century, before that, of course, we learned from you that in 19th century, the form of novel came in and it became a literary dominant form.
Mm-hmm.
Can we say that even till the 20th century or in the 20th century, the novel continued to dominate, and there were people who were writing songs, inspirational songs to stir up the freedom struggle, to talk about patriotism, but novel was a dominant form, sir?
In fact, novel struck roots in the 19th century and became a dominant form in the 20th century. Yeah, so you're rightly, you know, pointed this out. Novel emerged, and then it straight away took the literary world by storm. So in actually, the major fiction writers belong to the 20th century. Tagore is one example, who started writing in the 19th century, but he flowered into that kind of fiction only in the 20th century. Then you have another Bangla writer called Sharatchandra Chattopadhyay, who wrote Devdas and all the Charitrahin and novels like that, and he is second only to Tagore. Then you have in India the rise of Premchand, a great writer, a household name till today. And you have a large number of writers in all languages in India in the 20th century. And a novel actually played a very important role in the Indian context for this reason, that it offered descriptions of the different parts of India to a readership which would then think of India as a country. So that political role the novel was able to play. It doesn't mean that other forms became, you know, completely secondary. There were good poems written, and some elements of novels were adopted by tales also, like that Subhadra Kumari Chauhan's poem. It becomes a historical account of, 1857, when she talks about Khub Ladi Mardani, wo to Jhansi Wali Rani Thi. So Jhansi Wali Rani is fighting the Britishers, and there is an account. Now this could be turned into a novel also. So novel and poetry also came together in that sense. Now there are some poets in Hindi, for instance, like Maitri Sharan Gupt, who write epics in modern Hindi, and these epics are of a different sort than the epics earlier, and they tell stories. So this is a kind of a novel that is again there. For instance, he wrote an epic called Saket. Now Saket was to be a kind of replica of Ramayana, and Saket is actually Ayodhya. So he talked about Ayodhya there, and in that poem. And it goes into 9-10 cantos, and it's a big book, about 400 pages in verse, but then he's telling a story. And he's also at the same time raising two questions. One, that Ram is looking after the country, Ramchandra, and that there is another lady who always remained deprived of her husband's attention, and that woman was Lakshman's wife. So that way, Urmila. So he wrote about Urmila in particular in the 9th canto, and he gives songs there. So imagine he is able to mix, you know, the story of Ramayana into some kind of a verse as well as a description. And there he starts, you know, probing the psyche and the psychology hitherto, you know, unattended areas of, you know, womanhood. So that way, a novel played that role quite well there, and that's how, you know, literature went on in India. Now this kind of a process is common to literatures elsewhere in the world. And there is a time, for instance, in English literature when there is no drama. There are only religious pieces. This is till the 16th century in England. And suddenly there is a spurt in drama in the latter half of the 16th century. Why latter half? Even the last quarter of the 16th century, when, you know, a great crop of writers of merit, writers of sweep, writers of imagination, writer of invention, they suddenly come up. And I don't want to go into reasons how they came up. But then at the peak of these writers is Shakespeare. He starts writing in 1590s and he goes on up to 1612 or 1613, 1616 he dies. But then all his life he's been writing dramas. And he's known all over the world for his dramatic writing. And his drama was written not to be read. His drama was obviously written to be staged. And he never took care to get his plays published in the sense in which we publish plays today. So people must have compiled his plays later. Individual plays are available at the time when they were staged. They were also there for the reading of the public. But then maybe they were read more by the actors and the rest. And on his first edition of plays, collected plays at that time, came out only in 1620 or so, around that time. So by that time Shakespeare himself had died. So because publication was not the issue, the issue was staging of a plays, and those plays were full of appeal for the audience. Therefore, you see in England drama emerging, which didn't happen in the rest of the world as much. Why? This question should be considered. Maybe England at that time was visited by very vital conflicts. And for the conflict, I think the more suitable form is drama. Because there, you make characters speak their own mind. And if they disagree in life, then they express their disagreement through their lines that they speak. So just see, in life there must have been discussions. In life there must have been dissensions. There was a great increase in poverty in the 1590s, and that poverty also created certain sections of people who came onto the streets and fought against the police at that time. They protested, and Shakespeare shows this protest in the plays written in the 1590s and up to 1610. So he gives a large number of role to the masses there. So he's showing the masses and he's raising questions about them. Some people condemn them very harshly, but then he also gives voice to those people who face the challenge of this kind of condemnation. So literature and life, and Shakespeare was a political writer, as we understand it today. There are books, today which have the title Political Shakespeare, and there are subalterns in Shakespeare's books like this. So which means that literature played its part very well through capturing the ethos and the mood of the masses and the upper classes at a particular time, and holding a mirror up to the society and the audience that lived at the time. So I would conclude, friends, now with this. Of course, the same literature that Shakespeare produced finally led other writers to write Paradise Lost. Then in the 18th century, we had novels coming up, unlike India where novels came out only in the 19th century. But in the 18th century, there is a great crop of prose fiction in England, and that educated the masses in culture, in morality, etc. In the 18th century. In the 19th century, novels went still ahead, and they started focusing upon exploitation, economic exploitation. Particularly, I'm referring to Charles Dickens. And this is how it continues in the 20th century. There are different streams in English literature and European literature. So the point that I have made is today in this brief discussion is that literature and life cannot be separated. The problems of life are taken up in literature in a very serious form, and literary works and writers are read with great interest and keenness by the society, which learns a large number of lessons from literature. So this is how I conclude the discussion, and it can be carried on elsewhere at a different point.
Absolutely, maybe. Sir. I would perhaps like to convey from the reader's side that this was an indeed a very interesting discussion, and we could have so much more conversation about this. Sir, since we have 1 or 2 minutes left, I'd just like to pose a question to you, a slight query from my side. Just as we learned how instrumental the form of drama was in the literature in England, as we talked about also the drama of Shakespeare. And so with respect to that, sir, I want to ask you, when we talk about literature in India, we see how in the 20th century it was the form of novel became really dominant to voice the protest of the general public and also of the writers. Can we say that the drama also was figuring at some level?
In India?
Yes, sir. Did it become prominent?
Actually, so far as certain languages are concerned, drama was quite popular in the early 20th century. In fact, one of the modern Hindi writers is a dramatist. His name is Bharatendu Harishchandra. He starts with drama writing. But the problem with drama writing is which Shakespeare in England did not face. Because Shakespeare's England was an independent country. In fact, England remained independent all through and it became a colonizer. That's another area. But then England could afford to have dramatic writing staged in spite of the fact that it worked against them politically. But in India, if you took the drama, through drama, the political message to the stage, then it became such a threat that the state will come down heavily on it.
Right.
Therefore, the state would never allow the drama to prosper in India. So it will be, maybe there is a particular, play which has been staged once and next day the police would swoop on the actors and the stage people and it will be banned. So in the national movement, it became a really, a matter of fire, which might explode, any time, and that's how a drama was not given that kind of a chance. But yes, there were dramatists in India, and the nationalist drama was written in Hindi. Jaishankar Prasad is one example, and he used a very fine trick. He in his dramas, he did not take up the contemporary social themes. He went back to history and he started talking about the old kings and queens. He would talk about Ashoka and all, Chandragupta, for instance. There's a famous play written by him called Chandragupta. So the British regime would then say that, this kind of a thing is not concerning them. So they had their own strategies. So I like the question that drama is there, but it's not encouraged by the regime.
Right. Yes. Thank you so much, sir. And friends, we would like to wrap up the lecture, but of course, not forgetting what we learned from sir, that life and literature cannot be separated, and literature is not merely about entertainment, but a social factor which of course affects life, both serving both the ideas, entertainment, and trying to reflect life in a way that the reader is able to catch relevant things from it. So friends, thank you so much for watching, and with this we thank sir for being associated with us and coming here. Thank you so much, sir, and thank you friends for watching. Have a great day.